Good evening. Welcome to Vishwavahini TV. This is the Chat with Royal program, and my producer today is Vidura. With me, sun having been shining in the Koch family, it's now my turn to talk to Alston. I've been trying to get Alston on the program for a long time, but he's so busy that he comes in and the next day he's gone, or he's gone somewhere else and he's never been available to me. I think when I came back from Sri Lanka the last time, I said that Alston was present at my birthday dinner. I can tell you now that he did come, but he did go as well very, very quickly. So without further ado, Alston Koch, welcome to the program.
Thanks for having me, Rao.
Alston, it's been a long time.
I know, a long time between drinks, but sometimes...
These things happen.
Yeah.
You're domiciled in three locations.
Correct.
And you told me earlier that you had one leg in Sri Lanka, one leg in Los Angeles, and one leg in Black Rock.
Yes.
You must have been sort of Rolf Harris.
Yeah, well, if you look carefully, you'll see I've got three legs.
tell me, having come to Australia around 1971, you came to Sydney. While in Sydney, after your stint with the Jetliners, you were you sang with a band called Dark Tan.
That's right.
Was Dark Tan named because of you? Because of the color of your skin?
Yeah, well, I was the founder of the band. Mm. And what happened was that everywhere I looked in Australia, it was a very rock oriented country. Mm. I don't mean as rock, but musically, it was a very rock oriented country. And we had people like AC/DC, The Angels, you name it. And the only way forward, I thought, was to do something original and have an original band and an original name, because there was no real point in me doing something that everybody else did. I mean, I hate being a copycat, and to this day I still like doing my own thing. So yeah, so Dark Tan was born. Mm. And I just went out into the suburbs looking for other dark and tanned musicians.
It seemed to me that in those days when you were interviewed on Channel 10 specifically, you sat, lay back with your arm around on the chair, basically your legs cocked up. Was that the image that you tried to portray, or was that the real Alston?
Well, I was blessed in the fact that most of the interviewers, like you, for example, were my good friends. They became friends only after they came and saw me work with the band, and then they invited me on their shows. So I've been on Channel 9, Channel 7, Channel 10, on Donny Sutherland, on Countdown, on Sounds. Bandstand was one of the programs I really enjoyed doing. So I felt very comfortable, but it was like home to me. I mean, like, we were appearing every morning at around 7:15. On the Super Flying Fun Show on Channel 9. So we know everybody, we know the staff. So it was a sort of, if I might add, which might not be the right thing to say, there was a sort of a cocky appearance, which I think you're...
But that was a portrayal of the times, was it not?
Yes,
I think I remember Molly Meldrum sitting on a settee with his one leg underneath his butt.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So that was a sign of the time. And you always, in your industry, you have to sell yourself.
Yeah.
Because the next gig depends on how this man looks and how he sounds.
Exactly.
Right. So it wouldn't be really a fine thing to be, lifeless and portray as though you don't want to be there.
And it wasn't easy because we had to do something different all the time. And I was lucky because I didn't drink and I didn't smoke.
Mm.
And so when I came on the program at 7 o'clock in the morning, I was bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, whereas yes. sometimes the horse would be after a huge night.
I was told the story of Ernie Sigley, for example, before he did the Tonight Show. He'd be down at the pub. And 10 minutes going, where's Ernie? I don't know. Where's Ernie? Go down to the pub, he might be there. And Ernie, got 2 minutes to go. And he'd come, oh, all right, you know, I don't want to leave here. And he'd come and either after three or four beers, right? And he'd do his thing. But everybody doesn't have the luxury of doing that unless you're the star. Alston always fell on his feet. You have been very fortunate, not only in your career as a vocalist, but even in your marriage to one of the Alip girls who you met in Sri Lanka while you were up in the sticks of Mugegoda down that way.
Right.
You came out here and you married and lived in Sydney. And you have this lifelong thing of being who you are, acting, selling yourself, selling the fact that you are a vocalist. Gratefully and thankfully, you have a son and you have a daughter. You have a pigeon pair. Not to mention that you and I look like ends of a bookcase at the moment.
At the moment, yes.
But how did all these things evolve? How did you get to the stage in your life where a couple of years ago you also did what your son does best and became an actor? Now tell me a little bit about Alston and his evolving into this stage,
into the acting side of things. That was actually just by chance. The director of the film, Chandran Ratnam, we were going around the world looking to cast someone who could play the role of Matthew Pierce, and we went into all these casting agencies. And because that particular role was a demanding one, finding the others were no problem at all. In fact, I spoke to Jackie Fernandez and roped her in for the role of Dalreen. But we couldn't, at that time I was just one of the one of the guys who was just helping. You know, I was there was no title. I was not an executive director, executive producer, associate producer. No, I was just helping a mate. And we happened to walk into a club in Soho in London after a very disappointing 3 nights of casting. And I don't drink. Chandran rarely has a drink. And we went into this den of, you know, what can you say? It was not a place where a gentleman would walk in. But we had to, because Chandran wanted to drown his sorrows with a beer. So the only place open at 2 o'clock in the morning was this den of inequity. And we walked in there, and lo and behold, before we can even sit down, these ladies come from the dark and they sit with us, and there's champagne flowing. And we said, hey, we never ordered any of this. You know, we just walked in to have a beer. But then there were three bouncers who didn't like Chandran's attitude, and they came up to him and dragged him by the collar and took him up against the wall. And they were just about to give him
martial arts.
His first lesson in martial arts, when me, being a very small man, was wearing a truncheon jacket then. I thought, I can't let this happen. As a human being, I've never ever struck anybody with these hands, not even my son, or my daughter, or my dog when I had one. So I got up and I walked up to the biggest guy, looked at him straight in the eye, and I screamed at him. And the guy just stopped. Then he looked at me. I knew I had won. Because when a man doesn't swing his left or right arm that he has, but listens to you when you talk to him in a very loud voice, it means he's listening. Mm. So I told him what I had to say, and then he walked away from Chandran, walked away from us, and we didn't have to pay for any drinks, and we walked out of there happy as Larry. Soon as we got on the payment, Chandran looked at me and said, I found my Matthew Pierce.
Oh, okay.
Because no one would have played that role
in
real life the way I saw it being played out today. And the look on your face was the face that I thought I would want for the film. So that's how it happened.
You have always been a sort of laid back ambassador. And in true life, you have been ambassador for tourism in Sri Lanka and so on and so forth. Where do you get your calmness from, as you are right now?
Confidence. I think I was very lucky to be born with confidence. So I always try to impart on others a sort of aura when I walk into the room that they've got nothing to worry about because it's all fun. Mm. See, entertainment, Ryle, to me has always been fun. It's never been a job. Mm. I've never worked a day in my life. Oh, I've got to correct that. Mm. When I first came into Australia, I worked my butt off, not as an entertainer or a singer or a songwriter, but man, I had three jobs going, you know, and it was the most difficult thing I did. Mm. And that also showed me how to look after myself and the money I earned, which was a mere pittance.
Yeah.
As you know, when we all came in here, we weren't allowed more than, I think, £3.10.
Yeah, £2.10.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Right.
I was very fortunate. They allowed me £2.10, and Vital Bastards owed me some money, which I picked up in Singapore.
Yeah.
But realistically, though, you're quite correct that when we came out here, not only did we come with the £2.10, we had to prove to ourselves more than anybody else that we were doing the right thing, because you would have been similar to me. I came out here in 68. Between the time of picking up your passport at the Central Bank building and you becoming an Australian, your persona non grata, you know, you have nowhere to turn to, nobody to turn to, and you had to be yourself. Yes, you did have confidence. Yes, you carried your vocals with you, and you could always go and sing for your supper. But there was something far more important driving you, and that's the fact that you had a wife and you were going to have children and all that. And you have done very well for yourself. And I congratulate you and everybody like you who came here at that time and found their niche in life and did well. You, to your acting career with the current film, there was, of course, the fact that it had to go back and be re-edited and voices redone. Have you come to the end of that?
It's all been done. Everything has been done. And it's waiting for international release now. And the producers are hickering and bickering about pricing and prices and blah, 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 because it's a very, very unique subject at the moment.
Mm.
A subject that has been rattled through courts all over the world, not on the issue of the film, but the issue of religious priests and religious organizations taking the upper hand or taking you know.
But that precedence is, especially in Australia, I mean, we have a cardinal who's in jail for a lesser offense than what that priest did.
Correct.
So is it going to be an art house film, or is it going to be a film that is the public, open to public?
Yeah. Well, it was released in the country of origin where it happened, in Sri Lanka. It ran for 75 days in, I think, 47 cinemas, and it was a sellout. And the producers pulled the film out because they didn't want to have it being shown too much until they had an international release. My personal thought of this is that with the advent of various distributing companies like Netflix and Disflix and Datflix, where films are being made and shown, and also with the introduction of TV series, which are really exceptionally good, done sometimes even better than a film. For example, the series The Crown, I know whether you saw that, about Queen Elizabeth. Unbelievably photographed, film, directed,
and big money.
Acted. Yeah, so you come across films like that, and it's difficult when you have a Sri Lankan story coming out.
Is that actually a problem?
It is, because in the world out there, nobody wants to know a Sri Lankan story.
Yeah, because they still have 15, same population as Australia.
Exactly.
And is it a case of requiring international sales techniques?
Oh, it does. I mean, look at, you just brought up Australia. Has there ever been an Australian film that has done very well, unless it was released in Hollywood?
Yeah.
Except for Crocodile Dundee.
Yeah.
There's been very few.
Yeah.
I think they're doing a film now, which I hope will break that barrier, film on the Australian coming into Australia and taking over from the Aborigines. It has some beautiful actors in it, Jack Thompson and all that, but hopefully that might break the barrier. But Hollywood is the goal.
Yeah, so it's destined to become a movie on television.
Yeah.
SBS.
If it ever reaches that category. Yeah. But you need stories that are really, really, you know, attractive to the consumer now.
It is all the sales pitch, isn't it?
Yeah.
So my original question was, will it become an art house movie?
Probably.
It already is an art
probably,
house movie.
Probably, yeah.
Is there a scope for a second story?
Well, I've been approached to do a series two, but by the same token, there is a bigger story that has come out, and it's to do with... I don't know whether I should mention it because it hasn't been registered properly, but there's a bigger true story coming out of Sri Lanka that was during the time of the first governor Maitland and Lord Louis Mountbatten, and that era, which is absolutely mind-boggling. In fact, I've been researching it because it was landed on my lap, and that looks like a goa, because at least it has a British background.
And so they'll have a couple of British actors.
Oh, they'll have to.
The Lord Mountbatten.
Exactly. You
know, have to be Ben Kingsley. One of those big names. There's also another movie in the making, I'm told.
Yeah.
And that has got something to do with your wife.
Oh, yes. That's a strange one.
You never tell a newsman a story and hope that he holds it back.
Yeah. No. Well, my wife Yolande was in the final seven, I think, in the Miss World 1970, and that was.
And she came to Australia at that time.
Yes, she came to Australia as well. That was an amazing year, 1970, because it was the year that. A lot of things started. There was a protest about the use of beauty in pageants. There was Vietnam was on in a big way, And they had the Miss World, which was held in at the Royal Albert Hall, had Bob Hope, Engelbert Humperdinck, Glenn Campbell, Joan Collins, some of the biggest world stars actually not taking part, but being a part of the production.
Mm.
And they made a film of it now, and it's called Miss Behavior, not Miss World, Miss Behavior, because there was a lot of things that happened.
Yeah.
And lo and behold, they've got, they've cast, I think, an Indian girl as my wife in the film.
Now, talking about your wife and the Alips, of course, Yolande, your wife, was the younger sister.
No, I think she was the second, actually. I never checked on that.
Yeah.
I must. I think she's the second youngest. But what is unique is that both her sister, her younger sister for sure, and her were both Miss Ceylons.
Yes. Yeah. That's where I was going with this.
Right.
And
right.
Yasmin is very well known in Sri Lanka.
Yeah. She was a top model. And
I remember the name Yasmin,
where
I did not remember the name Yolande.
Yeah.
Because Yolande became Miss Ceylon just after I left
Sri Lanka. Yeah.
And of course, you know, in the early years of leaving Sri Lanka, there was enough news here to worry about the news here.
Exactly.
But the other things about your wife, of course, unfortunately, she's not here today. She's also a great dressmaker. She has supported you in ways of bringing home the bacon.
Oh, well, if I wouldn't be here today, not for her, because, she took a back step when I took a step forward. But I did actually introduce her to see whether she could further her career. And in fact, just yesterday, I saw on the news that June Daly Watkins died at the age of 92, and she was the best Australia ever had.
Mm.
And I remember introducing Yolande to June Daly Watkins at the time, because and she had something going for Yolande, but my wife was never too ambitious. Like even today, when you invited her on the show, she always thought of an excuse to bow out gracefully.
You can tell her from me that her sweets last Wednesday.
Yeah.
The Knickerbocker Glory, I think it
was
called.
Oh, right. Yes, yes.
Was excellent.
I will tell her.
And the last time I ate it would have been 60 years ago, when I was working at the United States Information Services. That was the last time I ate it.
Yeah.
I can't remember the taste, but I do remember the taste of the stuff that I ate at your place.
Oh, thanks. Yeah.
Elston, I'm going to show a clip so we'll come back and discuss that and we'll talk a little bit more.
Okay.
Has always played a major role in supporting tragedy like Live Aid did many, many years ago. And the youth of Sri Lanka and other countries struck by tsunami are very grateful to MTV and UNICEF. So please give generously today, tomorrow, and whenever it's needed.
Sri Lankan of the Year 2018.
So you have won numerous awards around the world, but today you're winning the Sri Lankan of the Year, the other Dharana Sri Lankan of the Year, right here in your motherland. How does this make you feel?
I am delighted and I am honored. The entertainment industry enthralled me since I was a child.
We've heard tonight that Alston is the son of the Sri Lankan soil, but I'll have to make a claim on him as well for Australia. He's one of those increasingly familiar phenomena that we see in Australia now. The person who's from overseas, who's gone there, made a success of things, and come back to his homeland to make success of things again.
Oh, oh, save by me, Diana. congratulate Alston for bringing the sense of glory to our country.
Our Hour, he's an incredible artist, internationally known, and it's a blessing to have him on the show. So thanks for coming.
It's a pleasure to have this man on the show. Video? For sure.
It's a pleasure to be right next to you.
Up of Sri Lanka, Namo, Namo.
Disco lady loves to dance. The disco lady loves romance. She knows the tune, she knows the cue. She loves the band, she loves the blues. The disco lady loves to dance. The disco lady.
Climate change affects everybody, not just human beings, but even the birds, the bees, and the animals of the forest. Because when climate changes, everybody suffers. So I believe this is something so, so important for us.
Alston Copperhead is an inspiration. Throughout his life, he has espoused causes which are deep-rooted in the survival of humanity and its upliftment.
The disco lady loves to dance. The disco lady loves romance. She knows the tune, she knows the cues. She loves the band, she loves the blues. The disco lady loves to dance. The disco lady.
I'm speaking to Alston Copp. As I said before, it's been a long road to get him onto a seat here and pin a mic to his shirt. But the other end of this bookend is alive and kicking. Alston, like most areas in life, there are people, 9 out of 10 people, especially the Sri Lankan culture, would maybe find something to criticize your career. Not that you care or give a damn about what anyone says, but you have the colors on the board and you have earned every one of them. What is Alston's agenda at the moment?
At the moment, I'm doing a few things in America. And I'm not doing too much in Australia because I found out towards the latter part of my life that Hollywood and America is where everything starts. And it started for people like Hugh Jackman and Mel Gibson and in the acting side of things and in the music side, with the Bee Gees and Olivia Newton-John. And it was all America. So I stepped into America perhaps a bit too late, but let's see.
Yeah, although you feel it was too late, you've been at the Academy Awards for 2 years running. Huh?
Yeah, I was actually a performer for the after party, and 3 years in a row. And It's something else. It's, you know, it's very hard to describe Hollywood and America because it's something you have to experience.
Mm.
You haven't reached the pinnacle of anything unless you reach the pinnacle of.
If you make it here, you'll make it everywhere.
Exactly, and that's unfortunately what is lacking in Australia.
Mm.
And most other countries, even England.
Mm.
I mean, the Rolling Stones didn't make it till they left to America.
Yeah.
The Beatles had to appear on the Ed Sullivan Show to make it in America and then make it right around the world. So for more reasons than one, that tag of America still persists to be there and will always be there.
Mm.
Unless you get some crazy, if I might call, I use a word my school teacher used to use, buffoons, like the gentleman who was put in jail this morning.
Mm. Yeah.
And that's the wrong way of doing things, you know. Yeah. So anyway.
But they'll always be that type of person. Yeah, you have to just be very careful. Because the United States right now has its extremely good points. It's also has its bad points, like everybody.
Yeah.
There are critics of the president and there are
those who love
him. And you have to learn to live with it.
Exactly.
And prove those critics wrong, or just don't give a damn about the critics and keep going on the same road.
But most critics, Ryle, are qualified.
Mm.
If you look at the qualified, I find that I love it when people criticize me because it gives me the strength.
Mm.
But what I find questionable are critics who are not qualified to criticize.
But having said that,
I
must tell you that the only bad publicity is no publicity.
Exactly. Right. As Kamal himself told me one day, he said, "Alston, the day I start worrying is the day they stop talking about me."
Yep. That's the time to worry about it.
Yeah.
I've said this to, you know, Derek Junkir. I've said this to Derek as well. The moment nobody starts talking about you, start worrying, right?
Yeah.
Somebody criticized Derek for showing his Mercedes and standing in front of him. Look, if you do what I did, you can achieve this. And that is buying a Mercedes, right? And that's a very good lesson to a lot of Sri Lankans who have just come out here.
Yeah.
Do what I'm doing and you can have Mercedes too. But there were a lot of critics about it. I said, don't worry about it.
Yeah.
The moment you start worrying about it, then you're foregoing your own need and your own want and just worrying about them. Only good publicity you have is some of the bad publicity as well. Tell me more. You are in and out of Australia.
Mm-hmm.
You have a beautiful home here.
Thank you.
It's neat, it's tidy, it's lovingly maintained. How do you do all this?
Well, actually, it's my wife. Behind every successful man, they say, is a woman. But I have a joke about that.
Yeah.
That she doesn't like. But I use it only as a joke.
Yeah.
Because I've changed it a little bit. I say, behind every successful man is a woman that his wife doesn't know about. But fortunately for her, there is no such woman.
Yeah.
Like, I've been married to her now, more than 45 years.
Mm.
You get less for murder.
Mm.
But, you know, I'm happy.
You wouldn't give her up for nuts.
No, no.
Because she'll take half the house.
Yes. Oh, no. That never came into question because... No, I mean, I absolutely adore the life I lead, and I'm, like I said, I'm satisfied, and I'm also
content.
Mm. Mm. And those two things are very important when making you confident.
Mm. Finally, you have 2 minutes. Tell me about the entertainer, Alston.
Oh, I love doing the songs that I love to sing because I wouldn't be doing it otherwise. My wife, my family, the girls who used to back me, who toured with me around the world, would tell you that I never rehearse. Never. You never find me going over the song 3-4 times or doing this, tuning up my voice even when I go on stage. I don't do that. I was with my good friend Frank Highfield, as you know, who did.
I remember.
Yeah. He came down for my 50th anniversary, and I bumped into him in the toilet. Well, we were always on talking terms, and we knew each other well. And that's why he came down for the show. But I bumped into him in the toilet at the hall, and I heard his voice, and I said, "Hey, aren't you supposed to be miming tonight?" And he said, "Yeah, but I got so used to doing this, I've got to keep my voice going." So then I said, "Look, would you believe I never do it? I never warm up my voice before I go on stage." And so I enjoy what I do. And
have you ever had any problems with your throat?
Never. I've sung with coughs, colds, flus, everything.
You don't smoke?
No.
You hardly drink?
No. Oh, no, I don't drink at all, actually.
You don't even have a glass of champagne now and then?
Although I must tell you, on my 50th anniversary, somebody brought me a brandy from somewhere. And I knocked it down because it was 2 minutes to showtime and I wasn't even changed. So that was the only time I ever had a drink, you know.
Alston Cock, I just want to touch on 2 things.
Yeah.
Very quickly.
You can touch on 3 if you like.
Yeah. All right. The 3 legs.
Yeah.
One is, you come from an entertaining family.
Yeah.
Your father, was, I'm not quite sure, was Fred Cock, was part of the Blue Ministers, and your father was too.
Yeah. They were both Freddies, actually.
Yeah.
My dad was Rick, and he was a part of the Black and White Minstrel Show.
Yeah.
And Freddie was also part of the minstrel show in the latter years of Sri Lanka.
And Fred, of course, is Loretta's father.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah. I always wanted to ask Fred this because he worked with my dad at D.V. Martinstein's. I always wanted to ask him whether when he proposed to his wife, if he went down on one knee and, you know.
Yeah.
Mammy.
Yeah. No, Uncle Freddie was just incredible. He was a lovely man, and he always had a joke up his sleeve. And he was a joker in the pack. And little things.
Yeah, he was life in the party.
Yeah. Little things that actually made a show that was so important, which is what is lacking today in theater and in entertainment, is just common sense comedy, you know.
The second thing is, you, I have said this to you before, 2 things that you do very well. One is, as an MC, you're excellent. Your mic technique, your speech, the way you talk and all that is absolutely excellent. And the other thing you're very good at is organizing big shows, which you did, I think, at the Grand a few years ago.
Yeah.
Any more coming up?
I'm very careful what I do or what I pick, because not everybody sometimes would like to give somebody else the power of putting a show together. Because I'm a bit of an authoritarian. I'm a disciplinarian, and I like a lot of discipline. In fact, I remember when I did my first show here, when I say my first show as a producer, I had all the artists, all Sri Lankan artists that were in Australia on this show. And I don't think, and I stand to be corrected, it's ever been done before, but I did everything timing-wise, the works, told them what to do, And then I said, I'm going to come down, I'm going to sit down. I'm not going to say anything or do anything. And they were shocked because they thought I'd be there swinging my arms and saying, oh, now you go on and this and that. But I said, no, you'll have, we rehearsed it, so now go and do it. You know.
Now, do you think my next guest is going to be Bertie Ekanayake?
Yes.
Do you think together with Bertie that you guys can do an international show here?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Yeah. Because there is a fabulous venue, which is in Fountain Gate.
Right.
It belongs to Casey Council. I don't know whether Casey Council will be there anymore, but that's an excellent venue. You can put 700 people in there. I think what is missing is to, yes, have Sri Lankan artists, but have international artists. It doesn't matter where they come from. And across the spectrum to have people from...
Of course.
Yeah.
See, it's the way to go and it can be done. And I just got two questions for you. You talked just now and you spoke of the name Casey. Is that Ron Casey?
Yeah.
Oh, well, he's a buddy of mine.
Yeah.
I performed for his 60th birthday when he had this huge estate in Sydney out in the sticks, because Ron was a racing man as well, besides being a radio man.
I think he called races.
That's right, yes. And so it is the same Casey, okay. And I've forgotten what the second question was.
Ah, good. I'm off the hook. Alston, thank you so much for coming on the program.
Right.
It's been a long time between drinks,
yes,
as you said.
Yeah.
I'm going to make an offer to you
right
now. And that offer is, so you can think about it, if you want to do a show and if you have a couple of guests that you would like to interview, please let me know. You have my blessing to sit here where I am and do the show. I hope you take it up.
But can I say something on that subject? I think you're doing a fantastic job. And why would you need someone like me? I mean, look, because you're so very relaxed and our opening conversation we talked on being confident, right?
Yeah.
And you're very confident in what you say. And I'm sure the people like you and the hosts like you and everybody that watches the show like you, you know? So keep it the way it is. I think
far be it from me.
Yeah.
I have given everybody I know an opportunity to do the program. I don't want to mention names, but Beverly Pinder has done the program.
All right.
Right. And Rob Fernanda has done the program. Mm-hmm. And two or three others have done the program in my absence. I cannot be selfish.
Yeah.
My program is about for the benefit of the Sri Lankan community.
Community, yeah.
Whether I talk to an Australian, an Indian, or a Pakistani, it doesn't really matter. It's for the benefit of the greater community. So the chair is yours. If you want to do an interview, please let me know.
Okay.
You can have the program. You can call it a chat with Alston or Cock and Bull, whatever.
Yeah. Beautiful.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ryle.
Thank you.
God bless. Vishwavahini.